JFT just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for February the 25th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, today I will talk about the equities bloodbath that continued on Monday as well on coronavirus fears. I will discuss gold, which hit its highest level since January 2013. I will also talk about the US dollar, which despite the risk of trading environment, traded lower against most of the other G10s on increasing Fed cut bets. Now, as for today, during the European morning, we already got the German GDP for the fourth quarter. Later in the day, we get the US Conference Board Consumer Sentiment Index, the American Petroleum Institute weekly report on crude oil inventories, and we also have two speakers on our agenda. And as it is always the case, let's start with the performance of the greenback against the other G10s. Now, the dollar traded lower against most of the other G10 currencies on Monday and during the Asian morning Tuesday. It lost the most ground versus the yen, the Swedish krona, and the euro in that order, while it managed to eke out some gains only versus the Canadian dollar. The greenback was found virtually unchanged against the Aussie and the pound. With regards to the broader market sentiment, we cannot derive safe conclusions just by looking at the performance in the FX world. Yes, the yen was the big winner, but can we rely on that? Last week, the yen was trading in a tumbling mode, even during risk-off periods. After all, the risk-linked currencies did not fall sharply against the dollar, which was also down instead of attracting heaven flows as well. Therefore, we prefer to turn our attention to the equity and bond markets. In the equity world, we see a bloodbath. Most major EU indices tumbled more than 4%, with Italy's FTSE MIB feeling the hit the most. The Italian index fell 5.43%, its biggest fall since August 24, 2015, while Wall Street followed suit, with all three of its main indices losing more than 3%. The tailspin rolled somewhat over into the Asian morning today, with Japan's Nikkei falling 3.34% and China's Shanghai Composite losing 0.60%. Strangely though, some markets tried to stabilize, with Hong Kong's Hang Seng trading virtually unchanged and South Korea's KO SPI gaining 1.18%. Now, the reaction in South Korea's KO SPI appears very strange to us, especially given that the nosedive in equities was the result of surging coronavirus cases in South Korea, Italy, and Iran. Now, in any case, although both cases and deaths are back into slowdown mode in a worldwide scale, fears of a fast spreading outside China may keep market participants on the edge of their seats. We can see here that the graphs I'm usually posting, showing the slowdown or acceleration in both cases and deaths on a day-by-day basis. We can see that cases remained in a slowdown mode, while deaths from acceleration, they return back to the slowdown territory. However, I repeat here that my view is that the deaths could well accelerate again, as they may follow a stable slowdown in cases with a decent lag. Now, with regards to the Asian markets, we said that we had some stabilization in some Asian indices, and market chatter suggests that the recovery in those indices may be owed to reports of a vaccine which will though be submitted for human tests in late April. But didn't we know that from last week? Yes, we did. As for our view, it has not changed. On the contrary, recent developments support it even further. Remember that even when stock indices were hitting record highs, we noted that the risks were asymmetrical and tilted to the downside. We also noted that with scientists saying that the virus is likely to spread more easily than previously believed, and with the vaccine trials set to start late April, the fastest, we still believe that the economic wounds could well drag into the second quarter. This may prompt investors to reduce further their risk exposures and seek shelter in safe havens. Even if equities rebound somewhat, we will treat such a move as a corrective bounce. In order to start examining the resumption of the prevailing uptrends, we would like to see clear evidence that the virus is indeed contained. Risk-linked currencies like the Aussie and the Kiwi are also likely to stay under selling interest, while safe havens like bonds, gold and the Swiss franc could prove to be the beneficiaries. We are still reluctant to trust the yen, despite being yesterday's main gainer. The reason is that last week it's been falling even during risk-off periods on concerns that the Japanese economy is headed towards a technical recession. Now, with regards to gold, the precious metal continued marching north yesterday, hitting resistance near 1689, a territory last seen back in January 2013. Then it entered a corrective mode, which continues today as well. Apart from heaven flows, gold may have accelerated higher early yesterday, also due to the weak dollar. The dollar failed to shine yesterday, and the reason may have been increasing bets over more cuts by the Fed. Up until last week, investors were pricing in one cut for this year, specifically in September. Now they anticipate more than two by December. Specifically, they are pricing in one 25 basis points cut in June, and another one to be delivered in November. So although the message we got from the latest FOMC meeting, as well by Chair Powell's testimony before Congress, is that the current level of interest rates remains appropriate, investors' concerns over the virus impact on the global economy have heightened, and with the Fed being one of the major central banks with ample room to ease further, they may be thinking that US policymakers should decide to act. What's more, the yield of the 10-year US Treasuries hit a record low on Monday, while its difference with the 3-month yield widened to minus 15 basis points. A yield curve inversion has preceded every recession in the past 50 years, and thus participants are closely watching it for indications on whether this could be the case in the world's largest economy. Now, as for today's events, during the European morning, we already got Germany's final GDP for the fourth quarter, which confirmed its initial estimate, namely that Eurozone's economic growth engine stagnated in the last three months of 2019. This also confirmed that the year-over-year rate dropped to 0.3% from 1.1% in the third quarter. Later in the day, we have the US Conference Board Consumer Sentiment Index for February, but no market consensus is currently available. With regards to the energy market, we get the American Petroleum Institute weekly report on crude oil inventories, but as it is always the case, no forecast is provided. We also have two speakers on today's agenda, and those are Fed Vice Chair Richard Clarida and Bank of Canada and Deputy Governor Timothy Lane. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great day. day, and I'm looking forward seeing you here again tomorrow. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock a.m. GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So, goodbye from me, and have a great day.
JFT, just fair and direct.